The first thing I remember about growing up in Scotland is the smell of my Scottish grandparents' house. Mothballs, meat and mashed potato. Contrast that to the Italian side of my family, the concepts are fused in my mind. Parmesan, pepper, love. Despite my mother's best efforts to elocute it out of me, I had a very broad Scottish accent. So they started taking the piss and calling me Jock. I walked into my apprenticeship as Barry Zonfrillo, and I would walk out as Jock, armed with the best cooking education in Scotland and some of the worst possible habits a lad could acquire along the way.
I asked for the bassin, I still haven't got it in. Why haven't I got the bassin, Stephen?
I decided I'd turn up at Marco Pierre White's restaurant in Hyde Park in London.
Have you gone through twice? Yes. Right.
Can I help you? Which tripped me up further, because you're not used to hearing that refined English accent from a guy who looks like he could break you in half with his bare hands. What do you want? I was standing there, sort of stammering and tripping over my words. I'm after a job.
Jock came to me when he was 17 years old. His enthusiasm was greater than his knowledge. But it was that enthusiasm which drove him. Maybe fueled by his fears of failure, by his insecurities, which I could relate to.
He was an incredible mentor. His kitchen was the first time in my career that I wasn't discriminated against for my accent, my age, or my rough edges.
We shared this bond because Marco's kitchens were tough, but they were also tight-knit. And once you worked in Marco's kitchen, you sort of were a brother in many ways to the other chefs.
Very few chefs have an inquisitive mind, an intellectual mind, and a creative mind.
I come from kitchens that were brutal. There's no other way to describe it. And a lot of us would finish work and just want to forget it, get it off our heads as much as possible. And that's how that kind of behavior starts. Heroin ends up being a drug that you take because you're in pain if you don't. I did my last shot of heroin on New Year's Eve in the toilets at Heathrow Airport. Like I'd done 1,000 times before, I would never take drugs again. When the plane landed in Sydney, I'd be free of all that. With hindsight, my workaholism in those years was just another symptom of a deeper psychological problem. What I told myself was healthy and honourable. Working hard to put food on the table was just another form of compulsive behaviour, which in the end was just another drug, and just as detrimental to forming healthy relationships. Now, I was twice divorced with a child from each marriage.
This is it, this was new way of life, right?
This is the way the new people used to live then.
I was incensed by Australia's lack of acknowledgement of its First Nations people in general and of their cuisine. The restaurant I envisaged would be called Arana, named for the word welcome in several Indigenous languages.
Jock meant like a son to me. He was one of the best, beautiful friends I've had and known.
Those nights were the first time in a long, long period that I felt at peace. I'll always be grateful to Bruno Dan and his family for allowing me to share that time with them. As imperfect and unsuitable a person as I am to speak about many things First Nation, I knew food, and Bruno recognised that my intentions were good. And beyond that, I think he saw that I had some healing to do that he could help with.
I love you, Jock, and I'm going to miss you. Have a safe journey where you're going now.
Deep down, I truly believe that he will stay with me forever.
Originality is only original if you're the first. And Jock was the first at what he did. And people have followed him. And that's what makes him special. That's what makes him rare. He took lots of risks. That was his nature, to take risks. And maybe in every aspect of his life.
When she walked through the door, she smiled. And I just knew. We were going to be a thing, and it was going to be wonderful. It was as simple as that.
So he flew back to Adelaide and then called me from the airport and said, you know, when am I going to see you again? I don't want to not be with you. And I said, well, I could probably fly down tonight. And so then I flew to Adelaide. And then we were just inseparable.
Now and then, I'd go out and introduce a dish to a diner still holding Alfie. And you'd see them do a very alarmed double take that I'd walked out of the kitchen holding a plate of guana in one hand and a baby in the other.
One word to describe each other.
Sensational.
Gorgeous.
Then, in October 2019, I got one of those dramatically life-changing phone calls. It was from the team behind MasterChef Australia, and they wanted to chat about maybe having me on as a judge.
No pressure, hey?
As we went on filming, I learned to manage my anxiety.
Morning. Coffee.
I'd come in early on set and make everyone coffees, because at the end of the day, feeding people and showing hospitality is what I love, and one of the few things that relaxes me. Whenever I was in danger of spinning off the planet entirely, food brought me back down. It was the anchor to my life, but it didn't give me happiness or peace or solace. Only one thing has ever done that for me, and that's my family. For most of my life, I thought I could only bring perfection into the world through food, but I was barking up the wrong tree. The only perfect thing I've ever created is my children. Give something back and try to leave the world in a better place than when you came into it. If there's one thing I've learned in life, it's that.